and welcome to The Future Report, a podcast hosted by social research company McCrindle for anyone curious about the future. My name is Ashley Fell, and each week I'll be sitting down with a guest to discuss a topic or trend that you need to know about. Since the beginning of the pandemic, for many, working from home has become the new normal. And while it can have its challenges, the benefits seem to outweigh them. So, if people love working from home and want to continue working this way into the future, where does that leave the future of the office? In today's episode, we're going to be talking about, is the office dead? What role does it play in the future of work? What this means for CBDs? And we're also going to discuss the Great Resignation and what leaders can do about it. So joining me today to tackle this topic is McCrindle's founder and principal, Mark McCrindle. Mark, welcome back to the Future Report podcast.
Thanks, Ash. Good to be here and discussing this topic.
It is a super interesting and very relevant topic at the moment. And before we delve into some of our research and our findings and our perspective on this, I wanted to get your personal take on working from home. Mark, do you enjoy working from home?
Yeah, I certainly got into it and appreciated the flexibility of it. My journey really mirrored that of what we found in our research of the average Australian's journey, and that is that when we suddenly, almost without notice, were all forced into working from home, we wondered how we were going to get by because we weren't set up for this. How are team meetings going to work? How are events and connections and training, how's that going to operate? What about collaboration and just project management? How is all of this going to work? But we found a way and we all adapted and we ended up with some great results through it all. And we started to enjoy the flexibility and balanced our life. We got into new rhythms and all of that was great. And then all of a sudden it was, okay, we're heading back to work now. And as we've started to ease back, while there was great excitement about that, cool, getting back with people and the interaction, there was also a sense of, oh, I'm going to have to get back into some normal structures rather than the flexibility that we did have. And so we've had to adjust once more. But those of us that have made our way back into the office, we certainly have appreciated it and we've recognized what we really missed. And that is the gathering, the collaboration, the discussion, just often the unplanned interactions through which so much happens, both professional development, ideas, solving of problems, as well as planning projects. So being in the room, being back has been great, but it has required an adjustment, just as the adjustment required where we headed out of the office first time round.
Mm. And we have asked many Australians this question, and I think it's really interesting to think about in terms of your preferred structure of working. Is it workplace all the time or the office all the time, or is it work from home all the time, or is it a hybrid of both? And I think most people like both elements. Is that fair to say for you, Mark, as well?
Yeah, it is. I line up with that majority. 61% said hybrid is the future for them. And these were of workers who had worked from home during COVID. So they know what workplace-based work is like. They know what work from home is like. And the vast majority, 61%, said, let's have a mix. Let's have some level of flexibility for our future. Only 14% wanted to continue what we had in the peak of the lockdowns. Let's all work from home all of the time. And only 25% said, let's have the good old days of us all in the office all of the time. So the majority have spoken. I think those of us that have experienced work from home say, you know, let's have a bit of flexibility where required, but let's not give up on the gathering, on the workforce together, because so much good stuff happens in that.
Yeah, it really does. And I'm sure anyone who has worked from home during the pandemic has gone back to the office. Maybe there was that hesitancy because it was a long time for many of us when we were in lockdown where you get used to working from home. And we touched on this a few episodes ago with Sophie talking about well-being when you work from home and acknowledging that everyone has had a different experience. Maybe if you don't have kids at home and you like the flexibility, then it was great. Maybe if you've got lots of different people in your household competing for your time, maybe it was better being in the office. So I think everyone's had a different experience and it's important certainly to acknowledge that. But there are benefits and challenges with working from home, as certainly, which is what our research has found. And, you know, we say that COVID has necessitated the largest and the biggest transformation to work in perhaps a century with this working from home era. And this topic that we're talking about today does point to the changing social fabric of society. You know, everyone working in offices for the last few decades is now kind of been pulled into question in the wake of the pandemic. And I wanted to ask you, Mark, do you think the changes to the way that we work will be one of the biggest impacts we'll see as a result of the pandemic?
Yeah, definitely. You know, it's been transformative in terms of just our social interactions, the way of life as we know it. It has been profoundly transformed. You know, the health impacts of COVID around the world have been tragic. The economic impacts have been big, but it's those social impacts that have been the most transformative. How we interact in our living space, in our home spaces, who comprises our households, the rhythms of our connections with community, where we're living, and indeed where we're working and how we're getting to work, all of that has been changed, and much of that has been changed for good. As I said, there will be some return back to the workplace, but maybe not in the full-time workaday, five-day-a-week approach that we had prior. And so the lasting impact of COVID will be here well after this little pathogen has been dealt with and we put that side of things, the pandemic side of things, to bed.
Yes, absolutely. And it reminds me of a study that we conducted last year in 2020 about, we wanted to sort of test our hypothesis, which is what we do with research all the time, around, you know, is the impact of the pandemic on Australians, what kind of area of life has it most impacted? And our hypothesis was that it would be the social impact, and that was what our research found. And that was, many people said it was the social impact of social distancing that had the biggest negative impact on their life rather than financial, mental or physical, which I guess we have a lot to be grateful for in Australia, where we didn't have that real physical impact. We didn't have maybe as many people impacted by COVID-19, the virus itself, than other countries. But not to undermine either the isolation that many people felt, especially when you take the workplace out of the equation or the office out of the equation, that we know many people rely on that for social interaction and connection. So yeah, big impacts on many of us.
Yeah, that's right. And it was a surprise to see how little the financial impacts were. Now, for some, they've been big. And for some industries and businesses, they've been dire. You know, hospitality, retail, cafes, travel, of course. But but for the average Australian, amazingly, after a recession and after the global uncertainty and after a pandemic, they've ended up actually with more savings. They were forced to spend less. A lot of the earnings either maintained their stability, or with government payments, for some, they even were better off. So, you know, that's quite a remarkable thing out of this pandemic and recession, is that our finances overall are in reasonable shape, and we're moving forward even with some social change that'll probably be healthy for our lifestyles and rhythms moving forward.
Yes, absolutely. So with this topic today, Mark, we've kind of, well, we've tried to set it up in terms of the previous episodes that we have and the topics we've explored in previous episodes of the podcast. We talked a few episodes ago with Sophie Renton about well-being in the work from home era, and we delved a little bit into the work from home trend and how people, when they are working from home, can look after themselves and prioritize their well-being. Then in our last episode, we talked about the rise of the regions with Jeff Braley, where we discussed the impact of people leaving the cities and the CBDs, moving to regional areas, because now in the work from home era, people can work more remotely and still retain sort of a traditional maybe city job. So that kind of does leave us with the question that I know that our team and you especially, Mark, have delivered a lot of commentary on, with that question and that sort of clickbaity topic we have dubbed the podcast today, with the office being dead. So I wanted to just ask you, Mark, do you think the office is dead?
Well, no, the office is alive and well and kicking and probably in great shape with a big future. And that's because the office is not about the building. It's not about the place. It's about the people. And people work best. In fact, we're wired to interact and to connect. And indeed, work is at its best when we come together for that productivity. You know, there are certain tasks, productivity-wise, that we can work well on alone. And people said that in the research, that they found the thinking and the report writing and some of that focused solo process worked better when they're at home. There weren't as many distractions. But the reason we have organizations is that we have an ability to come together with different skills and use the synergy of that energy and connection with each other to achieve greater outcomes than we could if we were alone. We have the ability to have different skill sets, a demarcation of skills. And when we bring those skill levels, those expertise, those domain knowledge strengths together, we as a group achieve more and better and bigger and faster than if we were trying to get all those skills done ourselves. So that outcome, that interaction, that connection, the ability to interact and to brainstorm and to collaborate and to innovate together, it happens best when we're in the room. Now, we can use technology. There's project management tasks, there's digital platforms, but there's something about the body language, the interaction, when there aren't the barriers, there's not the medium of the technology, that helps us flourish and connect and achieve tasks together in an office. So that's why it's so key. And it's important not just for the productivity and the task and the team focus, the alignment of values and the refocus on the vision, but because we have the social benefits, we have the collegiate benefits, we pick up tips from each other that we're not going to get through a formal Zoom session or a phone call. And so that betters us as individuals and as professionals as well. As you know, Ash, we wrote in that book on work wellbeing that, you know, to some work is simply a job, but to many more, it's a lifeline to social interaction and connection and real purpose and belonging. And so that's why the office has a big future. And that can't be replicated at home. I mean, some of it can, but not that true gathering, that connection, that collaboration, and that innovation, which really is what the future of work and our organizations depend on.
Yes, and I completely agree. And that quote, I think, in our work wellbeing book that we literally wrote and released and published in a pandemic year all about work. So it does reference the pandemic a lot. And that really was highlighted to me as well, that in a time of working from home and in our research, we found that the biggest challenge that people had while working from home was social isolation. And like to your point there, Mark, so many people do rely on the office and the workplace for that. In fact, we found that when we asked the question, in which of the following places do you experience meaningful and regular social connection and community, the top answer was workplace for 70% of people. And that was above their household, their local neighborhood, sporting activities, religious or worship community, hobby clubs, or volunteering opportunities with charities and community organizations. So I don't think we can undermine the role that the workplace plays for human beings, for their connection, for their social interaction. And maybe prior to the pandemic, we just thought, oh, how good would it be to have, you know, super long weekends and working from home all the time? Like, that sounds so glamorous. And then we actually were forced into it full time. And I think for many people, they actually realize the benefit of coming together and working in the same place as others, not just for the collaboration and productivity, but also for our own personal well-being. So hopefully that's maybe one positive thing among a few things that have come out of the pandemic, I think.
Yeah, definitely.
And it's interesting, I guess. So therefore, you know, we know that people are looking to work from home more in the future. Our research has found that. We've covered kind of those topics in the previous episodes of the podcast. The office isn't dead is what you have shared. So do you think, though, that offices will look different in the future because more people are working from home or in that hybrid way of working?
Yeah, they sure will change. They'll become fit for the new purpose that we have for offices and workspaces, which is not a quiet place to work. It's not about a workstation because we already have that at home. And if that's what we needed, we wouldn't have to take part in a commute. But the workplace, as we said, is going to be a gathering point. And that's what we can't do as well from an offsite location. So that means that the redesign will allow for more of those innovation hubs and connection places and meeting rooms and collaboration spaces, because that's what we're going to need. That's our reason for making the commute and heading in to connect and work together with other people. And so even though there might be fewer people on any given day as we had pre-pandemic in terms of numbers in the office, because if we end up with 4 days a week on average instead of five, that's immediately 20% fewer on any given day. Plus, over time, organizations do become streamlined with headcount. We can achieve more with fewer because we use technology, we use offshoring, organizations are able to get some efficiencies. And we find this right across the board in organizations that they're achieving greater outcomes. And you look at the headcount year by year and it does decline. That's just a sign of efficiency and productivity. So there's a trend towards fewer people and with work from home, perhaps even fewer, but it may be 20% or 30% less than we had pre-pandemic. But actually, we won't need smaller spaces because the workstations, we're going to get rid of some of those and put in more of those rooms and collaboration spaces, places for meetings and events and gathering. And so that's what is going to be required for the workplace. They might become fitted out with better kitchens and more of those informal spaces to facilitate the liminal aspects of life, the unplanned interactions. And, you know, keep in mind that it's not just about that office or workplace alone, but the context in which it sits with the cafes and the restaurants and the precinct of an office location. And all of that is important for the social interaction, the meetings with clients and the buzz that comes from that. So we might head into the office fewer days per week, but we'll be making a real intention when we go in. We'll be having our plans around that. They might even be slightly longer days as we fit more in, but they will be purposeful days and a lot more of that interaction than we would have thought of an office as a focus in the past.
And offices, like you've mentioned, I think we'll need to adapt and respond to the changing way people are working. And again, this was kind of backed up and backed up by some research we conducted earlier this year in our Australia Towards 2031 report. We asked about what environment best helps you experience a range of different elements of kind of the workplace. There was work-life balance, flexible working hours, deep thinking and reflection, which you would expect people to say, I get that more when I'm remote, when you don't have the distractions or the connection or kind of that relational element, you're kind of more task-orientated and focused. But then it was really interesting, I guess, as you would suspect, it was building strong relationships with leaders and colleagues, collaboration, professional development, and even the connection to the vision of an organization. Workers were more likely to say, I actually get that more in the workplace. And so we can't just dismiss those things, even though work from home is here to stay. And I was just reflecting as well on some research we conducted pre-pandemic in preparation for the Work Wellbeing book about how important are certain elements to people in their place of employment. And we tested like 17 or 18 different elements in this survey, and we found that workplace wellbeing was number one. Relationship with peers or colleagues was number two. And again, I just think those things really do happen in the workplace. And maybe that was even further highlighted to us when maybe if you were living in a place that was locked down and you did have to work from home, if that was possible for you, those things were even further kind of emphasized to us when we didn't have them, and maybe those things we did take for granted for so long. So yeah, hopefully offices do respond in even their makeup and leaders as well in terms of what they do use the office for going forward.
Yeah, that's so true. And I'm sure we all experienced this during work from home, that Zoom call after Zoom call or some of those online conferences or meetings, they became very efficient and indeed almost transactional. You were straight into the agenda. It's harder to have the banter. It's harder to have the social at the start of a Zoom. They start on time, they finish on time, see you later, close, done. And what we found is that we all felt quite exhausted because we were just packing it with utilitarian meetings without getting the social, the warm-up and the interaction that we normally have when we're gathered face-to-face. You grab the coffee or the chit-chat as you move into the meeting, and it's restorative. It allows for some downtime after the meeting, a quick reflection and planning and organizing things, resetting the room, and we get ready for the next one. And all of that, while we might think, well, it's lack of productivity, it's wasted time, is actually part of the rhythms of the social interaction and norms of our lives. And it has a refreshing aspect in our lives. It means that we can prepare for the next social interaction. Even those extroverts need some of those reset moments and reflection moments. And we lost that with the back-to-back Zoom. So it does highlight the benefits that come from gathering in an office and in a true meeting environment rather than just online. I'm sure we found it with events where we packed in lots of content, lots of speakers in those Zoom calls or workshops, but we perhaps didn't get the social aspect of those meetings, the networking and the interaction, which, as we found in our research on events prior, is one of the main reasons people go to conferences and events, is actually the networking and the social, not just the content. We can actually grab that through the Zoom. So, you know, I think we'll be healthier as we start to get back into workplaces.
Yes, and I can imagine many of us identify with that Zoom fatigue where you're just on Zoom after Zoom. And you're right, they're very focused on productivity. They're more transactional than maybe the same meeting that might take place in an office or in a workplace with other people. And something that I really missed as well was, you know, the humor aspect. I've laughed so much more since we've been back at the office, and it's just been around other people, and even hearing other people's laughter makes you laugh. And again, you don't really get that on Zoom as much as I think we tried to do that for our own, you know, team. And when we would do online presentations in meetings, Zoom was amazing. And we're very thankful that we could continue working through the pandemic and various lockdowns. But yeah, the humor, the laughter, the connection, and those things we get from, even like you said, at in-person events rather than virtual. And I remember when it was cool actually, for some reason I got to, or not for some reason, but there was a conference being held in Hamilton Island. That was the first interstate conference I got to do at the beginning of this year before Sydney went back into lockdown. And I was like, Hamilton Island, like, of all the places to have a conference, this is cool. And just that was an amazing experience to get on a plane again and go somewhere. But then also I remember just reflecting on, after delivering the presentation, I was like, there's just something about hearing people's laughter when they're in the room with you, getting the feedback, looking into people's eyes, you know, that real human interaction. And maybe that's something we'll see change even for the emerging generations who've grown up so tech savvy, but now they hopefully can again see the value of being in the classroom, or some of those things maybe that we again took for granted and we're just like, oh, back to school. Whereas now it's like back to school, back to the office. Maybe that's just the nerds among us. But anyway, hopefully it's been a good thing for many of us. So Mark, I guess we've talked about offices changing, and when you think about offices and the concentration of offices, people probably think the CBD, the central business district, our major capital cities. If people are working from home more in the future and there's more vacancy rates maybe with offices or that sort of thing, do you think CBDs will change as a result of this change in the way we work? And if so, how do you think they'll change?
Mm. Well, our CBDs will have a big future as well, because as we said, the office has a big future, and in some ways a more purposeful future, because again, heading into the office, it's not just for the workspace, but it's what happens around that and it's the interactions. And that'll bring life again to the cafes and the restaurants. Maybe the long lunches will make a comeback, something we haven't seen since the 90s, some of us who perhaps remember that. The after work connection points will matter. And so that'll really give a shot in the arm for the hospitality, cafe and events venues of our CBDs, but also it'll be refreshing for those that are partaking in those connections, because again, we're going into the office, we're going to make the most of those days that we're in there, and it can't just be within the walls of the building itself. We will see offices expand and add more of that life. So we won't necessarily get rid of too much space there, but other purposes will come into our CBD. They will become destinations for even more retail and entertainment and hospitality events and residences will pop up even more there. So I think the future of our CBDs will be more vibrant, more diverse, and therefore, you know, better than ever. And it's not just the CBD. We think of each city having one. It'll be multiple CBDs. You know, we are moving to this new city planning model right around the world, where people want to live, work and connect within a smaller area, maybe a 30-minute city rather than the big commute. Our cities, particularly in Australia, have been built on a sprawl and crawl model. They sprawl further and further out from the centre, and we crawl in every day, 5 days a week on a commute. And those suburbs end up almost being dormitory suburbs where no one's there in the day because they're all in the CBD. That's changing. And we're getting these CBDs, these workspaces right across the city. And so people won't have to head just into the one main one, but there'll be work hubs right across the city. And that'll provide life even in the outer suburbs, in the mid-ring suburbs, and that'll bring a lot more vibrancy to our cities, you know, outside of the 9 to 5 in the CBDs, because there'll be other reasons to stay around and connect. And also those suburban areas will have activity in the 9 to 5 because everyone won't have evacuated them to go into the main city. So I think the future of CBDs across our cities and regions will have a bright future as we readjust and reimagine and repurpose them over the years ahead.
And I'm sure that's a message that we don't tend to hear as much, because, you know, it's the kind of the opposite, like the office is dead, no one's going in anymore. But actually, when we do think about, again, I'm actually reflecting on some of the things you shared in our first episode of the podcast about the different ways we can look at trends. And it's not just technology that enables us to work from home, but it's actually human connection and the catalysts and things that change our behavior as COVID has. But yes, cities will look different, but they're not going to be sort of wastelands. They're still going to be relevant, but they will change, which is certainly, I think, an important message for people to be hearing and to be thinking about, especially if you've got an office in the CBD or you've got a business in the CBD. Hopefully that's a positive message that you can hear. I wanted to just touch on now, Mark, as a question about the perception that people have of work, and I've kind of alluded to it a couple of times already in the podcast today, just around how people view work and whether that has changed as a result of the pandemic. And we wrote a lot about that in the Work Wellbeing book, just around people's perception of work. We ran some questions, some really interesting studies around, you know, if you won the lottery, would you work again? Would you maybe work part-time, or would you quit your job? And that kind of gets to that pointy answer of how do people feel about their work? I do wonder if the pandemic has changed people's perception again, because it might've been something that we just took for granted and it was what we just had to get through to get to the weekend. You know, we hope that wasn't the case for people, but for some it might've been. And again, that quote that you shared, that work, for some work is just a job, but for many more, it is a lifeline to social interaction, purpose and belonging. So I wanted to ask you, do you think the pandemic has broadly changed people's perceptions of their work?
Yeah, it sure has, because it gave us a time to pause and to reflect and to reassess. You know, businesses, organizations really flow on momentum, and a lot of us just been doing what we're doing, and the pace of life is such that, you know, people were just continuing on the pathway they were on. But suddenly there's a massive pause in all areas of life and people get into a different pattern, and then it does allow them the space to reflect on what they had and what they're living, and is this the pathway that they want for the future? And I think that's a really healthy thing, and again, another positive to have come out of the great turmoil and tragedy of COVID. And I think that young people really give an example as to what the future of work is. When we, in some recent research we ran, asking young people who are starting careers, what are their key desires for the future careers? What's most determining their employment pathway as they look to their working future? 72%, the top of the list, said having purpose and meaning in my work. That's how many said it was extremely or very important. Number two on the list was work that aligns with my core values. And number three was a workplace that is a place of strong connection, so the social aspect to work. Number four was a work that has a positive impact on the world around them. And number five was workplace flexibility. So we get a sense from young people as to what they want in work. And it's not just to put in a fair day's work for a fair day's pay. They expect far more from work than that: meaning, purpose, values, social connection, and flexibility. And I think we've all paused and reflected and recognized that that is important. Now, prior to the pandemic, the Australian Bureau of Statistics had data which showed that more than 1 in 3 Australians said that they were often or always rushed or pressed for time. And it was even higher for women than men. And when we had time to pause and reflect on that, now people are saying, well, I do want more of those other things, what those young people are looking for. And as we start to re-engage back into some of the ways that we had, people are saying, well, I don't know that I want to get back to that 45 or 1 hour commute each day and each way. I'm not sure that I can put up with that job that just wasn't fulfilling or helping me thrive. Some of that research you mentioned in our book, Work Wellbeing, where we looked at at blockers to thriving at work. It was great to find that 1 in 5 Australians said, hey, no blockers to me thriving at work. I'm loving it. And that's fantastic. But for 4 in 5, there were some blockers. And as you said, most of them ultimately come down to workplace culture issues or to issues of leadership that leaders and managers can solve if they can really look at the situation of their staff and bring about some of those better outcomes. So yeah, we're not going to go back to how we had it. People for the good have reassessed, and moving forward, they're going to be expecting a bit more of that holistic and well-being balance to their work and ensuring that it achieves more than just paying the bills.
Yes, absolutely. And that really nicely leads me into this next kind of question I have. Just this topic around, in the media lately, there's been a lot of talk about and a lot of hype around something called the Great Resignation. And I think what it does point to is everything you were sharing just then in that answer about how we've reevaluated our lives and our priorities as we've all had to adjust our behavior based on the pandemic and what we have and haven't been allowed to do for an elongated period of time, almost in some ways, for the better part of the last 2 years. And I guess this Great Resignation is kind of the informal name for this widespread predicted trend that's going to happen of a significant number of workers leaving their jobs and resigning as a result of or during the pandemic. And what I've read up on is that it's drawing from the idea that how we spent our time maybe before the pandemic may not be how we want to spend our time after it, which is what you were just sharing around burnout and being pressed for time and constantly on the go and being really busy and almost like wearing that as a badge of honor. We've had to adjust that, and with this kind of reset with COVID, and for some people maybe who went, why was I spending so much time commuting, or why was I putting up with a workplace culture that doesn't value me, or I don't have alignment with, or I don't agree with the purpose of, or work is a detractor from my well-being. That's, I guess, what a lot of people are questioning and thinking about with the Great Resignation. And so I think that's just really a really interesting concept as we reevaluate what is important to us and our jobs and our work being such a big part of that. So Mark, I wanted to ask you what you think about the Great Resignation. Do you think it's an accurate sort of depiction of, is this trend, like, is it happening? And do you think it's accurate in a global context, in an Australian context, as to, yeah, how people are reevaluating their lives sort of post-ish pandemic?
Yeah. Yes, it does hold some logic and some data, that concept, and we will start to see increasing churn in the workforce and increasing resignations, particularly as we move into next year and the stable part of next year. You know, not a lot happens in January. It's not the time to sort of leave a job. Things are a bit uncertain, maybe even into February. But if economies are doing well and as people feel a bit more certainty as to how COVID is going around the world, people will feel confident to make a change, to leave a place where they're not flourishing. And so part of it is the individual situation. As we said, people are demanding more, and there are personal reasons why we will see it increase. But partly, it's also macroeconomic reasons. I mean, just look at the supply side of labour at the moment. What we have, take a country like Australia, we've had closed borders for a year and a half, and we're a nation that relies on overseas skilled workers, and there's been no one coming in to fill a lot of those gaps. We've had a lot of people that have not taken up roles and have moved into further study or haven't felt the need to move into particular roles. So there hasn't been a lot of people coming in to fill those gaps. In fact, as the economy has continued to grow, there's been an increase in demand for that labour, but there hasn't been that same supply. We've got an ageing workforce in Australia, and that means more retirement's coming. And so as we end up with more people leaving the workforce than joining it, as we end up with less people coming into the nation, at least in recent times, we've had more jobs available than people to fill those jobs. And so that creates an employees' market, where if they're not happy with the role, they can say, you know what, I'm going to move on. We've already seen shortages in skills emerge. We've seen an emerging war for talent, and that's going to come on even more as we move into the new year. So they're part of the macro reasons we're facing this situation where employees have more leverage in that employment transaction. And so we'll be wants to look around and to move on if they're not flourishing in a role. but also those personal reasons, as we have suggested. You know, you've got a lot of people come February or March next year when the employers say, all right, time to come back into the office now. We've done the work from home, but we can see the way forward. We're coming back. And you're going to have some employees say, well, I can't come back because I've moved. I'm 3 hours away from the work, or yeah. I'm interstate. Sorry, I can't come back. I can work from home. And if it means coming back, then they'll look for a new role. We've had some that have been holding on to the jobs. Maybe they've delayed retirement because, hey, it was easy enough to work from home. And when they've got to get back in the office, they say, you know what, I'm not ready for that. And so they will move on from those roles. We've had quite low turnover job change. In the last year, it's been record low. It's been about 7% of the workforce have changed jobs in the last 12 months. That's about half what we normally have. So as we move to 2022, we're going to have your last year's non-movers that normally would be part of that 15, 14, 15% that move on, added to next year's 15% mobility. And so we'll have extra churn or turnover as well. So all of those factors will come together to create this great resignation. I think that does create a challenge for employers to make sure they're understanding this, recognizing the reality of it, and ensuring that they can find the right setup to attract and retain staff in this new shortage and economic reality.
Mm. Yeah, that was a really helpful, I think, explanation of that trend there. And that must be a pretty scary prospect for leaders to think, oh my gosh, are my staff, are some of my best team members, are they going to get up and leave in the coming months or, into next year, as you said, as maybe things start to settle and we get a little bit more comfortable and back to some rhythms post sort of this kind of time of great rapid change, you're constantly, trying to keep up with different restrictions and things like that. And we've talked a lot about, and again, in the Work Wellbeing book, the need for leaders to be creating workplaces that people want to be at. And that talks to the culture of an organization and creating a strong culture. And that's our whole definition of this work wellbeing term, is it's when our work contributes to and enhances our sense of meaning, purpose, and contribution in life. That's our definition of that sort of phrase that we coined for the book, and workplace leaders play a key role in that. So Mark, as a final question for you, in this sort of time of maybe a great resignation coming for people, what advice do you have for leaders or people who might be hoping to avoid this great resignation happening in their workplaces?
Yeah, well, I think for employers, that are facing an impending great resignation, they can focus on the great retention. What are we going to do to retain our team? And I think this is a healthy thing in an employment situation where employees have a bit more power, a bit more say in the equation, because they ought not be at the whim of an employer. It's a challenge when there's high unemployment, because it does give too much power and too much imbalance to the employer, who can call the shots and move staff on. This actually means that employers have to make good. It keeps them honest to make sure that they're not that workforce where four and five are working that say, I've got blockers to me thriving. It ensures they focus on the team and invest in the team. It ensures that they make sure that the culture is right, that the feedback to the team is right. They can celebrate the wins. They can be clear on the values. They can be authentic in that. They can be aligned on the vision and really communicate that effectively and recognize the hard work of the team in monetary and, importantly, non-monetary ways, and that they can have a collegiate and collaborative and positive workplace environment. And as they provide that, that will lead to the great retention. And those that don't, it's a positive thing that employees move on to a place where they can provide and find better flourishing in their life. And hopefully it'll lift the continuous improvement of the old place so that they also can provide a better outcome. Organizations have to deliver for the community, and the number one community is their workforce community. And from there, it impacts society as a whole. And if employers are put on a bit of notice to make sure they can sort out what's happening with the teams, then I think that's going to be great and provide a better environment for employees, and particularly set them up well for the next generation who may not put up with what the past generation did, that autocratic leadership style, the lack of collaboration and participation, the old school structures and the hierarchies and the power imbalance, and maybe, you know, thinking that the paycheck is the only thank you that people need. No, we need to provide more than that. And it's organizations that do, that really offer what employees say they want, which is work that can achieve more than just job security and earnings. It provides a real thoroughfare of contribution, meaning, purpose, and collaboration. And when we get that right, society is better, the people are better, and the organization will be better because there'll be engagement, positive employer brand, great promotion of that organization. And of course, the team will stay longer, and that tenure is going to be helpful as well. So, you know, I think it's a helpful time. If the great resignation leads to a great retention, that's going to be a win-win for all.
Absolutely. And hopefully, again, the offices aren't dead, and they're full of life and vibrancy on the days that people are in. And it was, as you were giving that answer, I was reflecting on a quote that you created, Mark, and we put in the Work Wellbeing book, which is, many young people leave jobs not because there is a compelling reason to leave, but because there is no compelling reason to stay. And I think that's something that employers and leaders need to be thinking about as people come back after the experience of the last 2 years, as people have reevaluated, as they've worked from home, as they've shifted what they value in maybe in some ways, and that reprioritization has occurred. And I also, when we talk about attracting and retaining employees in our presentations, I also love to share one quote, because we talk about a school leaver today having 18 jobs across 6 careers, which is phenomenal career mobility. And when I share that with people in presentations, you kind of see people looking like a bit wide-eyed, like, are you serious? The employees that I have worked hard to get, who maybe hopefully they love and they appreciate, they're worried that they're, you know, going to move on and maybe in this great resignation sort of time. And one quote that I love to share, and I feel like people really agree with, is from Richard Branson, who said, train people well enough so they can leave, but treat them well enough so they don't want to. And hopefully that is, and your answer there, Mark, is empowering people and encouraging leaders to go, I've got power to create the workforce that people want to be at, that, like you said, is work that is purposeful and meaningful and allows them to contribute and is an enhancer of their well-being and their life overall, rather than something that they've just got to get through to live through to the weekend, which is a lot of what we talk about in the Work Wellbeing book. And yeah, I love that kind of flip it on its head. Don't think about the great resignation, but the great retention. And that is the opportunity that lies ahead for many employers and leaders if they can grab a hold of it and make the workplace and the office a place that people want to be. So amazing insights, Mark. Thank you. Always great to chat through a topic that I know you're really passionate about. You've got some great insights on. So thanks so much for your insights on the podcast today.
Thanks so much, Ash.
And looking ahead, as always, we're going to dive into some really interesting episodes that we've got coming up on the Future Report to talk about the future and the research and the trends that we're gathering to help you be better equipped for the future. So as always, for more insights about the future, you can subscribe to our podcast on Apple or Spotify to get those notifications of when we release a new episode each week on a Wednesday. We record the episodes, so they're up on YouTube if you want to watch the visuals see me hold up the books that we have written and things like that. You can visit McCrindle.com for our latest research and insights, or you can follow us on socials or wherever you listen to your podcasts as well. So thank you again for listening, and bye for now.